I guess life imposed itself today, and we're all bearing the brunt of it. When I heard of my Uncle Chris's passing, I was angry. Angry with him and angry with his struggles. As time passed and I had processed a little, after speaking with Mark and Leanna, I realized I wasn't upset with him, rather I was angry with the fact that I won't get to see him again. He sure was funny as hell, and he had a way with words, and that's putting it lightly. I can think of a thousand funny stories, but I couldn't do justice. And even if I tried to tell them, I know he'd be looking down on me, telling me to leave the funny to the funny people. I was having a hard time thinking of what to say today because I didn't want to leave anything out. He was close with a lot of people, and I'm sure there are a ton of stories that everyone could tell. From those of you that hunted with him, I'm sure you could tell endless stories of him imitating Elmer Fudd. Or stories from coaches, from DHL, from the firehouse, from fishing trips, or from the neighborhood growing up. So I guess I start to wonder why I am standing here today. I guess representing the cousins, I think it's because we became close. Because Chris helped me work through some of my own struggles. He was always there to lend an ear. He always had your back. We found a common ground, and we were always there to hear each other out or cry out whatever we were worried about. And then we'd laugh at ourselves for being such wusses, although he probably would have used a few other choice words that I won't repeat here in church. I know we had a similar relationship with most of you, if not all of you. We bonded over many things, whether it was the Phillies, whatever was going on with the elections, or a particular old John Wayne movie he loved. He sure was a wealth of useless information. Chris loved music, and he loved to sing, and although many didn't necessarily want to hear him belting out a John Denver song or a tune from the musical Wicked, he actually had a pretty good singing voice, some of them. If what I can remember, one of his favorites was a tune called When I Die, by Blood, Sweat, and Tears. He would belt it out, stating as the song goes, how he was not scared of dying. He loved his parents and his brothers and sisters, even if he didn't always agree with them. Chris had a hard exterior sometimes, and although he was a softy at heart, he loved his children more than life itself. Leanna, you really were Daddy's little girl. And Mark, you're his little buddy. He spoke most highly of you two. He would light up every time he talked about you guys. He loved to see Leanna get dressed up and dance. And Mark, whenever he knew you were coming over, he'd run around like mad, thinking of what he could do to make you feel more welcome. He loved having you guys near. Chris struggled with many things in life, but I think he always wanted to have the best intentions. And although he was very good at sharing his feelings most of the time, at other times he was tight as a clam, and you weren't getting much more than what he called the hairy eyeball. However, if you were to give him the hairy eyeball and stare you square in the face and say, "Don't you look at me in that tone of voice," about 8 years ago, we decided to continue a family tradition from Czechoslovakia of making kalupkis and pierogies in my parents' kitchen at Christmas time. After laughing, yelling at each other, and in true Betzel fashion, arguing for hours over how to make them, or whether or not to put applesauce in the kalupkis, we started telling each other that the other was ruining Christmas, thus coining the phrase and starting a tradition that has continued and grown ever since. I think we'll all miss him at that event. I remember my father, Joe, and my adopted uncles, Rob and Mike, and Chris would be working on whatever project in the backyard or in the man cave, and he was sure to remind them what he claimed they were messing up on by telling them, "You're doing it wrong!" My father and he would go at it on almost every topic, Chris usually instigating, which I think he secretly did to keep his big brother near to him. Whenever we were together, I was sure to hear them start to bicker, and then I would burst into the famous tune, da-dum, 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 and remind you of how much they were like Oscar and Felix from The Odd Couple. They would chuckle and move on to the next bull-headed argument about everything and nothing. Chris never held back. He was always in your face and able to bring out the best and the worst in everybody. He was truly a torture. He could really get under anybody's skin with his teasing. I used to dream about beating the hell out of him. But then again, I guess my father took care of that a couple years ago. Chris was the first to admit that he deserved it. He looked up to his big brother, Joe, and he always reminded me of how he would wait for you to come home when he was a kid because he would hang with him and talk to him. This is something I don't think ever stopped. Chris liked to get to know people. He liked to get deep, and he liked to cry often about whatever was bothering him. I think it helped him understand the other people. But I think more than anything, it allowed him to also understand himself and to work through his own struggles. And I know that despite it all, even if he were here today, he'd still find a joke. And then maybe even in this solemn moment, he'd call out yet another famous quote from one of his favorite classic movies that we all know. And he'd look me square in the eye and he'd say, "Sentimental hogwash." I'm sure many of you have a million funny stories of him. Cherish them. Carry them with you. You'll be sorely missed, Uncle Chris. Rest in peace.